Welcome back to Combat Tech. I'm Steven, and in today's video, we're diving deep into the state of US shipbuilding. Picture this: vast steel giants gliding across the open seas, loaded with cutting-edge technology that could shape the balance of global power. The United States is a maritime nation with a storied legacy. Yet how prepared are we to maintain our status as a naval superpower in an ever-changing world? You're about to find out. Strap in, because the state of US shipbuilding is more than a story of steel and rivets. It's a tale about innovation, economics, and the delicate race against time.
But shipbuilding moves around. It's very active in this country in the 60s and into Korea in the 70s and into China in the, 90s or 2000 period.
By the end of this video, you'll not only understand why the US Navy is pushing for more modern ships, but you'll also learn about a few head-turning, surprising twists that you might never see coming. And trust me, you won't want to miss the big reveal of how this could shape the future of global maritime dynamics. But first, did you know there's a little-known facet of shipbuilding that involves one of the most critical bottlenecks in the entire defense industry? It's something that has the potential to slow even the most advanced programs to a crawl, and we'll uncover what that is a bit later in this story. Stay tuned. The United States' naval might has been a cornerstone of its global influence since World War II. From nuclear submarines that can circle the globe without surfacing, to aircraft carriers that serve as floating air bases, America's shipbuilding story is one of constant evolution. But if you dig deeper into the Congressional Research Service's insights on the state of US shipbuilding, you'll find that this is no walk in the park. It's a complex labyrinth of budgetary constraints, shifting strategic goals, and an industrial base that might be stretched thinner than you'd expect. For instance, it costs more to build one Ford-class aircraft carrier than the entire GDP of some small nations. Surprised? That's not an exaggeration. The USS Gerald R. Ford alone is reported to exceed $13 billion in procurement costs. And that's before we factor in the aircraft and future maintenance expenses. When you think about that kind of funding, you start to see how enormous these programs really are. So, where do we stand now? The US Navy has publicly targeted a future fleet that hovers somewhere above 300 ships. You've probably heard the figure 355 ships tossed around in news articles or official statements. More recently, higher numbers like 370 or even 500 have been hinted at in long-term conceptual plans, including combinations of crewed and uncrewed vessels. Regardless of the final count, the emphasis is on building a versatile fleet that addresses everything from high-end warfare to humanitarian assistance. At the center of it all, the US shipbuilding industrial base. We're talking about legendary yards like Newport News, shipbuilding in Virginia, Bath Iron Works in Maine, Ingalls Shipbuilding in Mississippi, and the electric boat facilities focusing on submarines. These shipyards are national assets. There's no sugarcoating it. But as these facilities balance new construction, repairs, and modernization, the capacity and workforce constraints become very real. Here's a surprising fact. Despite the extraordinary skill of these shipyards, the workforce pipeline isn't as robust as one might hope. Skilled welders, electricians, and engineers are in short supply. Add in global pandemic's ripple effects, supply chain bottlenecks, and the pressure intensifies. One delay can cascade through multiple programs, causing schedule slippages and cost overruns that run into the billions. But hold on, these challenges also push innovation in ways we never anticipated. In a moment, we'll talk about how some next-gen technologies are transforming not just the ships themselves, but also the way we build them. And trust me, it's like witnessing a science fiction concept become reality. Let's take a tour of some key classes of ships in development or already under construction. Columbia-class submarines.
We are embarking on advanced construction of the newest fleet of ballistic missile submarines, the Columbia class, which will be replacing the aging Ohio class ballistic missile submarines.
This new class of ballistic missile subs is set to replace the aging Ohio class. They're nuclear powered, stealthy, and form part of the strategic nuclear deterrent backbone. No pressure, right? With each sub estimated to cost about $8 billion or more, the margin for error is incredibly slim. Scheduling is tight, as the first Columbia sub is needed to be fully operational to maintain a continuous deterrent. Ford-class aircraft carriers. The next generation carriers come with electromagnetic aircraft launch systems, advanced arresting gear, and automation to reduce crew size. The learning curve on these new systems has been steep, to say the least, causing some eye-popping headlines about delays and malfunctions in earlier stages. Still, the potential payoff is huge: higher sortie rates and improved efficiency. We recently did a deep dive into the Ford class, which is linked in this video, Constellation-class frigates.
The frigate program was put in place because of failures on the littoral combat ship program. It's going to cost about $22 billion over the next few decades to procure about 20 ships.
Designed as a more agile, frigate-sized surface combatant, this program aims to fill a gap between the larger Arleigh Burke destroyers and the smaller littoral combat ships. Emphasizing advanced radars, sonar, and missile capabilities, these frigates could be a big leap in multi-mission capability if they stay on track. We also covered the Constellation class in more depth, which we've also linked in this video. Unmanned vessels. And then there's the future wave, uncrewed or minimally crewed vessels that leverage AI for missions like surveillance or even anti-submarine warfare. This is the wild frontier of naval warfare. The concept deploys smaller, less expensive ships that can network together, gather data, and even engage in combat scenarios. It's not a distant dream. It's in pilot programs and early trials right now. Here's a quick piece of trivia that might blow your mind. The Navy is seriously exploring large autonomous submarines that could one day prowl the seas without a single human on board. It sounds like something out of a sci-fi novel, but it's a real avenue of research. Now, remember that bottleneck we hinted at earlier? The short answer is workforce and facilities. It's not just about pouring steel. It's about having the welders, the electrical engineers, the naval architects, people with specialized skills that take years to develop. Modern warships are loaded with advanced electronics, requiring specialized knowledge that can't simply be outsourced to just anyone. And then there's the question of budget. Defense budgets must contend with other national priorities like healthcare, education, and infrastructure. The tension between wanting to build enough ships to maintain a robust global presence and maintaining fiscal responsibility is a never-ending balancing act. The Congressional Research Service frequently points out that decisions made today will affect fleet composition decades down the road. Whether it's a single new hull or a program for advanced unmanned vessels, every decision has strategic consequences. Oh, and let's not forget shipyard modernization. Many of America's public shipyards are older than the ships they build or maintain, requiring upgrades that cost billions but yield crucial long-term benefits like faster production cycles. Just around the corner, we're going to talk about a major paradigm shift in how these ships might be designed, one that could change everything we know about building a Navy. Don't go anywhere. Let's dive into some of the advanced techniques the industry is starting to adopt. Digital shipbuilding, leveraging 3D modeling, augmented reality, and digital twins, shipbuilders can identify potential design conflicts before they ever cut steel.
When you think about the value stream for shipbuilding, we design, we engineer, we procure material, we plan, we manufacture, and we assemble and test.
This reduces costly rework and speeds up final assembly. Modular construction. Instead of building an entire ship from the keel up in one spot, shipyards fabricate sections or modules in different locations, then piece them together like giant Lego blocks. This approach has been used for a while, but is now more refined thanks to better engineering software and improved oversight. Robotics and automation. From welding robots to automated guided vehicles, the push to streamline production is real.
Shipbuilding is nothing like automotive manufacture where you have a lot of the same parts.
Robotics can perform repetitive tasks with a level of precision that reduces error rates. It's not perfect. Robots can't fully replace skilled workers, but they lighten the load significantly. We are entering a new era in shipbuilding where tomorrow's vessels might be churned out faster, cheaper, and with fewer defects than ever before. If you're enjoying this dive into military tech and strategy, smash that like button and subscribe for more insights on cutting-edge military developments. And here's a question for you. What new technology do you think will change warfare? Let us know in the comments. Your viewpoint could spark an entire new discussion. Why is all this so crucial, you might ask? The world is changing. Naval power isn't just about big ships bristling with missiles. It's about ensuring your nation can protect global trade routes, respond to humanitarian crises, and maintain a strategic edge over potential adversaries. Regions like the South China Sea and the Arctic are becoming hotbeds of competition. The US Navy's ability to operate effectively across the globe, relying on a technologically advanced and sufficiently numerous fleet, is key to US foreign policy and defense strategy. But guess what? Here's a shocking twist. Other nations, including China, have focused intensely on expanding their own shipbuilding capacity and technology. China's naval ship count has surged, surpassing the US in raw numbers, though a direct comparison is complicated because of differences in vessel types and capabilities. Still, their robust commercial and military shipbuilding infrastructure is a reminder that the US doesn't hold an uncontested lead in the maritime arena. Now for that big reveal we promised.
rapidly growing the size of their Navy. And here we are on the sidelines. It's, you know, we need to get more ships that are out there.
The Navy isn't just building ships. It's building an integrated maritime network. Future vessels, be they destroyers, frigates, carriers, or autonomous drones, are all being designed to share information seamlessly. Think of it like a massive ocean-spanning mesh network where every platform feeds intelligence to every other platform in real time. One ship detects a submarine, instantly the carrier and accompanying destroyers have that data. A drone overhead spots incoming threats, the entire task force sees it too. This integrated approach means that fewer ships, if networked effectively, can act with the synergy of a larger fleet. It's a force multiplier, but designing and building ships with that level of connectivity is no small feat. It demands a new approach to electronics, communication systems, and battle management software.
We used to make so many ships. We don't make them anymore very much, but we're going to make them very fast, very soon.
For the viewer, the effect is mesmerizing. A glimpse into a future where the line between digital and physical warfare blurs. Missiles guided by shared sensor data, unmanned vessels taking on the most hazardous missions, and manned ships orchestrating it all from a secure vantage point. This is the frontier of naval operations, and shipbuilding is the first domino that must fall perfectly into place. So where does all this lead? The Congressional Research Service underscores a few crucial takeaways. Consistency in funding. Long-term, stable budgets are essential. Without predictability, shipbuilders can't plan workforce development or invest in upgraded facilities. Balancing the fleet. The U.S. doesn't just need large, sophisticated ships. It also needs smaller, more flexible vessels and support assets to handle diverse missions. Innovation over tradition. From AI-driven unmanned systems to digital twin technology, the Navy must keep pushing boundaries. Relying solely on traditional methods or legacy platforms could leave critical gaps in capability. Global collaboration, partnerships with allies for technology sharing and even co-production might offset costs and speed up timelines. One example is the AUKUS deal with Australia and the UK, which includes technology sharing on nuclear-powered submarines. This is an unprecedented move that signals closer defense and shipbuilding collaboration. And that's just scratching the surface. The big question for you, dear viewer, is, will the U.S. shipbuilding enterprise evolve fast enough to meet the challenges of tomorrow? We've journeyed through the complexities, from budget battles and labor shortages to astonishing high-tech marvels like AI-driven vessels. We've seen how the industrial base, these massive shipyards, has to juggle time, money, and advanced technology to keep the Navy afloat, no pun intended. And most importantly, we've glimpsed a future where integrated networks and unmanned platforms become the linchpins of naval supremacy. If you're as fascinated by these developments as we are, hit the subscribe button and join our community of enthusiasts. We regularly discuss how next-generation military technologies are shaping the global stage, and let us know in the comments which emerging naval tech you think will most radically redefine warfare in the next decade. The race is on and the seas are vast, but the U.S. Navy isn't just building ships, it's building the future of maritime dominance. The question remains, can it launch fast enough to stay ahead of the tide? Only time and some serious innovation will tell.